Okay, so today we'll discuss about biodiversity, chapter 7 of our book. So I have here several pictures. Kindly identify which do you like better, A or B? How about here, A or B? Here, A or B? Now, what do you think biodiversity means? So what does bio means? Bio, of course, means life. Diversity refers to variety. And biodiversity is the variety of life on Earth and the essential interdependence of all living things. And scientists have identified around 2 million species, but still 10 million more remains unknown. And this is because of the tremendous variety of life on Earth, possible done or made possible by complex interaction among all living things, including microscopic species like algae and the mites. Now, biodiversity is a new term. It was coined only in 1992 during the Convention on Biodiversity. In that convention, they defined it as the variability among living organisms from all sources, including all the ecological complexes of which they are a part. This includes diversity within species, between species, and ecosystem. And again, in the same year, the International Union for the Conservation of Nature defined biodiversity as the totality of genes, species, and ecosystem in a region. So with this definition, we can say that there are three components of biodiversity. The first one is diversity of genes. So like what we have in the picture, they're all dogs, right? But the Chihuahua, the Beagle, and the Rottweiler are not exactly the same. Why? Because their genes are different. So it's the same with us. Though you have the same parents, the mother and the father are the same. You don't look exactly the same with your sister or brother. Why? Because your genetic makeup are different. The same with the diversity of species. We have monkey, dragonflies, and flowers, the middle beauty. They're all different species. Each organism is considered. Okay, the next is the ecosystem diversity. So it refers to different types of ecosystem that is present. So like what we have discussed in the biome, there are different types of biome. So this represents diversity in ecosystem. So the tropical rainforest is different from the taiga, the tundra. The same with the pond, it's different from lake, river, stream, and the marine ecosystem. Now, with our discussion of diversity, which do you think is more diverse, A or B? So it's B. How about here, which is more diverse? B is more diverse. Here, of course, B is more diverse. Here, it's B. Here, it's B. Because like what we have here in the picture, they're all exactly the same. It does not represent biodiversity. But the second picture shows diversity, not only with the physical appearance, but also cultural diversity. Here, which is more diverse? B is more diverse. Here, B is more diverse. So if you notice, this is this one, this A is a farm, and this is how man would think. We want things in order, but if you look into the natural ecosystem, like what we have in the forest, it is diverse. Why? Because this is how man thinks. So we want to have equality. We want to have order. But nature doesn't think that way. Nature is designed to accommodate diversity. Now, biodiversity has intrinsic value, meaning something that has value in and of itself. Alone, it's important. No, biodiversity is important. Biodiversity also have utilitarian value. The utilitarian value means there is a value, something, or the value something has a mean to another end. So what are the utilitarian values that we can get from biodiversity? Goods, services, information. So what do we get specifically from biodiversity? Oxygen, food, clean water, medicine, aesthetics, ideas. Aside from that, biodiversity has a lot of economic benefit. Like some Mangyan can use a tuber called nami. It serves as their food. And for the early people, they're using nipa palm fronds as roofing material for homes. And around 10 to 13% of total animal protein are being provided by coral reefs. And most of our bodies of water or our ecosystem serves as important sources for livelihood. That includes the Laguna Dibay and other lakes. But what is more important is the ecological benefit of our biodiversity. Why? Forests as an ecosystem are good climate stabilizers. So I think this explains why we are having now what we call as climate change, because our forests are being destroyed. And at the same time, we are experiencing flooding. And why? Because our forests are being destroyed and the trees within the forest absorb rainwater. Watersheds supply water to Metro Manila residents, and the diversity in microorganisms also breaks down dead plants and animals. So imagine what will happen to the earth if there are no microbes that would degrade no decaying materials. Then mangroves are spawning ground to fishes and other crustaceans. Now, why should we care about biodiversity? Should we be concerned about it? Of course, the answer is yes. Why? Because there is an extinction that is going on. So the earth is losing species at an alarming rate. There's an estimate that 3 species are going extinct per hour, and around 20,000 extinction occurs each year. When the species of plants and animals go extinct, many other species are affected. Now, what causes this extinction? Several reasons. One is habitat destruction, pollution, species introduction, global climate change, and exploitation. I think each one is self-explanatory. Now, let's focus into what is the current status of our biodiversity, specifically the Philippines. Now, the Philippines is known as a mega diverse country. It's a hotspot. Why? The Philippines has high species diversity and at the same time high endemicity. When we say endemic, organisms are exclusively native to a place or biota. Specifically, so endemic meaning found only in the Philippines, and we have a lot of endemic organisms. Now, since they are found only in the Philippines, that makes it immediately endangered. Endangered is defined as the species present in such a small number, and that is at risk of extinction. So, why is this so? Why is this? What is the reason why the Philippines is a mega diverse country and at the same time a biological hotspot? One reason is the patchiness of isolated islands. We have 7,107 islands, making the distribution of organisms difficult. So making them very much isolated. So if one organism is found only in one island, it will be difficult for the organism to transfer and invade other areas. Plus, the tropical location of the country, and the one extensive areas of the rainforest. So what are the endemic organisms? Let's start with the birds. So the Philippines is home to some of the most exotic birds. There are around 577 bird species around the Philippine archipelago, and out of that, 185 are endemic. However, 116 are threatened or near threatened. So this is according to BirdLife International. This is an international organization that is focused on the monitoring of the bird species, of bird species. So what causes the endangerment? They're large, they can easily be seen, and they are vulnerable to being shot. They are trapped for pets or food. The habitat are being destroyed, and they are restricted to one or two islands. So the first bird that we will discuss, I think everybody's familiar with it, the Philippine eagle or the Petecophaga jiferii. So please take note of the scientific name. In the exam, we will focus on to the scientific name, or I'll be using the scientific name. These are one of the world's largest eagle. I think you're familiar with the Petecophaga because of the story of Pamana. These birds are eating snakes, hornbill, monkeys. That's why they're also known as monkey-eating eagle. And there's an estimate of 100 to 300 organism or representative. And that makes it in danger of extinction. So it's too saddening to hear the story of Pamana, that several months after he was sent to the wild, the bird died because of a gunshot. Okay, so other endangered organism, we have the red-vented cockatoo, the Palawan peacock. These are endemic, at the same time endangered. They are found only in the Philippines. The Sulu hornbill, and then we have the black shama. This one, if you remember the film or the documentary by Richard Gutierrez. So this is what he's talking about. Then we have the Cebu flower pecker. This is considered extinct already. Then we have the Negros bleeding heart pigeon. Why? Because of the red color or the red feather on the breast part. So that's why it's known as the bleeding heart. We have the red-bellied pita and then the Visayan hornbill. Then we have the grand rhabdorns or rhabdornis. These are actually bato-bato. Very similar to Maya. They are endemic but still widespread. Then our deer, Cervus alfredi, the Philippine spotted deer, now found only in the Philippines. And in 1996, they estimated that only 900 are believed to be surviving, and this number might be smaller now because that's in 1996. Now we have the largest endangered animal, Bubalus mindorensis or the tamarau, endemic to Mindoro. So in 1900s, they have estimated that there are 10,000 heads of the organism, but it went down to 369. And in the late 1980s, they believe that as few as 20 heads are roaming in the wild. So that explains why we cannot find tamarau in the zoos nowadays. Even me, I haven't seen a live tamarau, only in pictures or stuffed. Then we have the tarsier, the Philippine tarsier or the Tarsius sirita. These are very cute, small organisms found in the islands of Samar, Leyte and Bohol and Mindanao. And very nice, they look like rodents, but they cannot close their eyes because they don't have an upper eyelid. And they can turn their head 160 degrees. Then we have the Palawan bear cat. You have the world's smallest hoof mammal, the pilandok, Tragalus nigricans, found in Palawan. I've seen this also when I went to Davao. Then we have the dugong-dugong or the sikaw. It's sometimes they have called it as mermaid because it looks like man from afar and it has tail, but actually it's a sea. It's a marine mammal, and the biology says that it can survive more than 70 years. Then we have the bats. We have the largest bats, the golden calf fruit bat found in Subic. Then we also have the smallest bat, the Philippine bamboo bat. Then we have the Mindoro pallid flying fox, the smallest flying fox. And then we have the tube nose bat. Look at the nose. So it's tubed. Then we have the Dobsomia chapmani. It's a bareback bat. This one is presumably extinct. Then we have the kaguang. This is the flying lemur found in the Visayas region. They called it the skaguang because it looks like a rodent. It looks like a mouse. It has wings. So it's also, the size is like half body of man, the torso. They call it a skaguang, similar to aswang, because it looks like a beast, as they say. Now we have the Visayan warty pig, the giant cloud rat. The Visayan warty pig is endangered in 1994, but late 1900s or early 2000, it was declared already critically endangered. Then we have the reptiles. Remember Lolong, the world's largest reptile. These are the saltwater crocodile. Then we have some frogs found only in the Philippines, like this, the Barbarula buswangensis, found in Buswanga or in Coron, Culion, Palawan. Then we have our grace monitor lizard, Varanus olivaceus. Then our turtles, the Philippine water is visited by several species of turtles. We have the olive ridley, the hawksbill, the Philippine green turtle. Then we have here the leatherback. This one I tried sending to the water in a conservation site in Bataan. Then we have the world's largest fish. This is the Rinkodon typhus. This is considered as the largest fish in the world. This is the whale shark. You can find it in Donsol, in Sorsogon. I tried swimming together with the whale fish in Oslob, Cebu. Then we have the world's smallest fish is found in the Philippines, Pandaka pygmaea. However, it's extinct. It used to be found in Malabon River in 1925, but now you can see it only on the 10 centavo coin. But don't worry, we still have the smallest commercial fish, that is Sinarapan, Miss Ichis lucenensis. So it would take 1,000 to fill a tablespoon. They are very small. I think it's being used as omelette. Then others, we have the blue spotted angelfish. Even our anchovy or dilis is endemic and is endangered under the sea. We have also exotic seahorses, and the Philippines is one of the largest exporter of seahorse in China, Hong Kong, and Taiwan. So what else are found only in the Philippines? The giant clams, Tridacna gigas. This can be found in Bulinao. I've seen one in Camiguin. Then we have the smallest shell, the Pisidium, less than 1 millimeter long. We have the most expensive shell, Conus gloria maris. For the plants, we have some endemic. Mabolo is endemic, pili, bignay. Then our flowers, rather, Vanda sanderiana. And our ecosystem. Now, our ecosystem is diverse. We have different type of forest. We have dipterocarp found in Sierra Madre, Siburan. We have the montan or the mid-montan in Mount Kitanglad, mossy or cloud, Mount Isarog, Mount Apo. We have the pine forest in Mount Balbalasang Balbalan, the limestone or the karst forest in El Nido, and the ultra basic and the ultra mafic in Dinagat. So these different types of forests varies on what are the most dominant trees and the type of soil that they have, also their elevation. So the dipterocarp, this contains the woody trees, I think lawan, the different types of lawan, nara, the same with montan and mid-montan. However, they differ in the elevation. Mossy or cloud forests are the highest mountain. So it's cloud because the upper portion is oftenly covered with clouds. The pine forest, the major vegetation are the pine trees like those in Benguet. Then limestone or the karst forest because the area is primarily made up of limestone. Then the ultra basic and the ultra mafic forest are the kind of forest that is rich in heavy metals or minerals like those in Dinagat in Surigao. Aside from the forest, the Philippines also has marginal ecosystem, agricultural, urban, freshwater, mangrove, seagrasses, coral reef, and the soft bottom. Now, we are discussing biodiversity because we are interested on conservation. So primarily, there are two types of conservation methods, in situ and ex situ. In situ, organisms are protected in their natural habitat. How can you do that? By proclaiming area a protected area. If it's protected, you cannot do mining, logging. Sometimes fees are being collected if you want to go there to protect the environment. So example are the national parks, natural monuments, protected landscape and seascape, and some natural biotic areas. Ex situ is when you remove the organism, place it in captivity, and you take care of it. So example are zoological gardens, aquarium, and captive breeding center. Now, to protect biodiversity, we have several laws. The first one is RA 7586 or the NIPAS, National Integrated Protected Areas Act. In this law, you tend to the government identified implementing rules and regulation on how an area can be declared as protected and how will they regulate it. That's under this law. Then we have RA 8371 or the IPRA, Indigenous Peoples' Rights Act. giving a right to the indigenous people on their ancestral domain. So, additional rights are given to them. Then we have RA-7160, the local government code, wherein extra power is given to the local government to protect and take care of their natural resources. Then RA-8550, the Philippine Fisheries Code of 1998. This includes several regulations on the Philippine waters, how to protect fishing. So here, they enumerated that several methods should not be utilized for fishing, like dynamite fishing, cyanide, muruami, etc. Then we have RA-9147, the Wildlife Resources Conservation and Protection Act. So this prohibits illegal trade of wildlife and at the same time abuse of wildlife. So you cannot just kill pamana. The one who killed pamana has violated RA-9147. Then we have RA-9072, the National Caves and Cave Resources Management and Protection Act. So this is primarily on the protection of our caves. Aside from our laws, there are international conventions. International conventions are a meeting attended by different representatives of each country wherein they discuss problems of the environment and to look for solutions, no, for these identified problems. So the first one is Convention on Biological Diversity. So here they have mentioned, they have defined what is diversity. Then several projects and researches are done to protect and conserve our biodiversity. Then we have the Bonn Convention, the Convention on Migratory Species of Wild Animals. So this is named as Bonn because it happened in Bonn, Germany. So here, they have agreed that if a migratory species passes through your area, we cannot easily kill them. They are being protected by the Bonn Convention. So the migratory birds that visits Pampanga are being protected by this convention. So we have the CITES, the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Flora and Fauna. This explains why you cannot buy immediately tarsier and bring it to other countries. That is against the CITES. Then we have the Ramsar Convention on Wetlands. So it's more on the protection of the wetland. Why? Because most of our wetlands now are being converted to agricultural utilization, but ecologically, wetlands perform important role. Then we have the WHC or the World Heritage Convention. So in this meeting, they identify World Heritage Site. If it's declared as such, additional protection is being imposed, and at the same time, they give an amount or a money that will be used for the protection of the site. Then let's go with the IUCN categories. So the International Union for the Conservation of Nature identified categories. So this is based on the current number and at the same time, the current human activities that affects the species. So the first one is the extinct category. There are two under this, extinct and then the extinct in the wild. If it's extinct, there are no living survivors. Example, dinosaurs are extinct. The dodo bird are extinct. Then we have the extinct in the wild, meaning all surviving survivors are placed in captivity. The Philippine eagle was once declared extinct in the wild. Then we have the threatened category. We have three: critically endangered, endangered, vulnerable. So if it's under the threatened category, meaning the number is declining and human activities that would cause its decline are very much present. Now, there are threats. So we have three: critically endangered, endangered, and vulnerable. The difference between the three is, of course, the number. The least is the critically endangered. Then you have the endangered and the vulnerable. Lower extinction, meaning the number is declining, but not enough to be considered endangered. So we have the near threatened and the least concerned. And then we also have categories such as data deficient, meaning no studies are conducted yet. That's why they do not have data that would tell if which category that the species falls into. Not evaluated, meaning they are not they are not concerned on it yet. They are not evaluated. So example, maybe housefly, the cockroaches. So these are not evaluated categories. So this is the things that I want to finish or discuss with chapter 8. So I would say read the book and good luck on your exam.